no better truth than that. That in spite of everything going on in the world, all the uncertainty of life, all the heartache and the hardships, that because of who Jesus is and what he's done for us, that it's well with our soul. Amen. Last night, I got a kind of uninterrupted note, not intended, from a mutual friend of a pastor that we knew that was leaving California for a new assignment in Utah, and traveled out there and arrived yesterday with his family, just to fall in the midst of his move and pass away. And it's just, I just can't help but stop in these moments and say, but because of who Jesus is and what he's done for us, that he who knew no sin became our sin so that we might become his righteousness, that I don't mourn for that man, do I? Because he is happier today than he was yesterday, amen? Now we should pray for his family. Don't misunderstand me. This was not planned and this is tragic. And yet, I am the one that preaches regularly, there's no bad news in the kingdom of God, and I believe that to be true today. And so forgive me, I'll pull this apart more next week, because I'm not preaching today, I promise. I'm not. We got a preaching upgrade, a pastor from Uganda, our church planter, Cyprian, will be bringing the word. But it's just a reminder for us this morning that these songs that we sing are more than just songs. This is the theology that penetrates our hearts and changes our lives. And so I'm bawling with my kids last night saying, you don't understand, and they don't, and that's okay. But we gather to be reminded of how good our God is. And so don't forget that this morning. Our vision as a church, when we planted this church, was to build joy-filled communities of faith, plural. And so that includes church plants locally, regionally, but also internationally. And so we have the great privilege of being connected with two partner countries and really cities and areas. One of them is in Uganda with Pastor Cyprian Masambe, and he's here with us this morning. But before I introduce Cyprian, I want to introduce you to a couple of our team members that just got back. So Nick and Andy, why don't you come on up here? And this is who and what we're about. And so Nick and Andy have really been a part of Vintage Grace since the very beginning in lots of different ways. I first want to introduce you to this young, handsome man next to me here. I say he's handsome because he's my father, and so I think it's only appropriate that he's a good-looking guy. Again, I've got some more hair than he does still, but Andy Soderstrom, I've been a part of our church really because of me since the beginning, but connected with us, but really recently you've left pastoral ministry and now been focusing full-time serving in Uganda with Cyprian and a ministry called Frontier Force Christian Ministries. Now here's kind of a timeline. What are we looking at here? What are all these names? What are all these places?
These represent all the villages that we planted church, and one down on the right that's not yet. And these are villages in rural Uganda where there is no gospel witness. That's what we're targeting, places that haven't heard Jesus. And to go in there with the good news of Jesus and make disciples and plant churches.
Does it sound familiar? Sounds like everything we want to be. In fact, what I love, and Cyprian and I have spent many times talking about this in my living room and hopefully someday in your living room soon. But where we say, on many levels, I love, we support Cyprian, but let's just be really honest. We're just trying to be like what God's doing in Cyprian. Right? I mean, we're supporting him, but this is the model. In fact, let's be honest, church, we planted one church last year. We've got two more that we're working on right now, but we are way behind. 10 churches really in the last 10 years. And so brother, thank you for your faithfulness to preaching the word, to preaching the gospel. And so don't miss this. This is beautiful. This is what we mean when we say building joy-filled communities of faith, plural. And on some level, part of this is even inspirational as we consider this campus in Placerville. As we pray about, God, what are you inviting us into? Because most of us are not thinking about South Lake Tahoe as a future church location, are we? I mean, vacation maybe, but we're not typically thinking about South Lake Tahoe. And we aren't either at Vintage Grace, but I'm committed that Placerville would be, because that's close. Because it's a closer proximity. And that's our prayer. Even as we look at your church planting strategy, we're just going where our people already are, where disciples are making disciples, and that's where church plants are really sprouting up. Now, Nick Franco, you've been a part of Vintage as a church plant for 3.5 years almost. Now, two months ago, you were sitting in a service, and last month you were in Uganda. How did that happen?
Yeah, I still can't believe that actually all came out to just happen. Yeah, we were sitting in church, and they were talking about some of the missions that were going on, and would you guys like to be included? Anybody would like to be interested in it? And I was like, we should go, Ash, because we're pregnant right now, we're building, we're doing all these, we're switching jobs, and all these things are
job transition, building on their house, and his wife's pregnant. And during service, he leans over and says, babe, we should go to Africa. And Ashley, you weren't here at first service, but what did you say, Ashley? You laughed.
Yeah.
Whatever you say, Nick. Yeah, and a month later, you're in Africa.
Yeah, that's it.
And so what did you experience? Again, you felt like God stirring your heart. You went, we had a need, you went there. What did you experience in Africa?
Well, before that, it was just amazing that through all that, it just all the walls got knocked down to be able to make it easy to go. And I was just blown away by that. And also, I was like, oh, well, how can I really be used on this trip? And like, well, we need pictures, and also we are looking to do a dental clinic and medical clinic. And I was like, well, okay, if you're knocking on the door, Lord, how could I not listen to that? So, yeah, but when I was there, yeah, just seeing the joy of these people, the kids, I got to spend time with them and hang out and just, I'd love to tell you a lot, but come Thursday.
Yeah,
we're going to talk more about that.
And it was fun. Nick and I got to connect a little bit, and Nick just said, Drew, you preach the joy gospel, this idea there's more joy in Jesus, joyful communities of faith, but Drew, you don't get it. You don't get it till you've gone to Uganda, till you get to see it on these faces. You were telling me stories of the milk cartons, of the cardboard boxes.
Yeah, just how happy they are in, you know, just whatever strings they could put together to make a jump rope or towing behind a little carton milk like it's an animal or you know, it was just, so they were so happy doing the most simplistic and things that they could find, trash. I mean, playing with trash and cardboards. People
made a little bit of an impression on your heart.
Yeah, people were asking me, like, was it so sad? I was like, you know, I was so happy to see how happy they were and how much joy they had with, you know, during worship and just playing with these kids with who had nothing.
Yeah, and so part of our heart working with Cyprian and his team is we do want to meet physical needs, whether it be the water filtration systems that you guys as a church have provided, thank you for that, whether it be sending dental teams and medical teams, but most importantly, it's the preaching of the word and the pastors that Cyprian is training and multiplying and discipling others as they disciple others. So Andy, you get a privilege of being a part of this as well, and so tell us what's going on in this picture here.
Yeah, if you want to plant a church that multiplies churches, you got to begin by making disciples that multiply. And so you need disciples to make churches. And this guy up here in the far left-hand corner, this guy's name is Stevenson Mazungu. I think Nick and I are related because they call us Mazungu as well. But you'll have to come Thursday. We'll explain how that works. But he's up in the corner, and that's our Frontier Force Bible Institute, where we have our representatives from each of our churches come, and we make sure they bring young people who are being trained and interested in learning God's word. And he's very interested there. He is a part of a church in a town called Chirwa, which is a church plant from the Kanalachi Church that you helped build their building. And just about 6 weeks ago, Cyprian and I were there, and we were able to go down to the river, and we baptized 33 people, and Mazungu was one of them.
Wow.
And you see the next picture of him just jumping out of the water, ready to go. And this guy is serious. He sent me a Facebook Messenger note the other day, and he wanted me to explain Melchizedek. If you can explain Melchizedek on a Facebook Messenger, I'm all ears. But these guys are hungry for the word, and our goal is to really begin by making disciples who make disciples and plant churches in areas that have not heard about Jesus Christ yet. And that's simply what we do.
So make no mistake, church, I feel fortunate that we as a church get to partner with these guys as they are building joyful communities of faith on many levels better than us. So we are thankful to learn with them and from them. I wanted to show you the picture again of the church. So thank you for your generosity. The church on the left that you guys got to build last year, as well as some of the leaders on the right there. And
this church, along with the Chirwa Church you saw coming in 2018, there's a place called Malabagambo Forest, and it's a place where there's a lot of evil, and they've decided that we are going there to plant a church. It's about 10 kilometers away. There's no roads there, but a little dirt road. If the pastors want to plant the church, it's 10 kilometers on foot, but we're really praying for a way to get transportation down there so we can begin to develop a relationship in the Malabagambo Forest to plant a church there.
So I want to say that Malagambo?
Malabagambo.
Okay, you got it? Malagabango.
Malamagambo.
Okay, you all say it.
Malamagambo.
That. So church, when we heard about this just a couple weeks ago, again, Godfrey is the pastor's name. In fact, you see the sliver of his body there right in the middle.
That's most of his body. He's a really thin guy.
That's most of his body. Okay. So that's, again, I've not met Godfrey, but that's most of his body there. And so Godfrey's been praying for Vigo. So Cyprian, but I want you to come on up here real quick, because when we heard... when we heard about one of your pastors that needed a vehicle to plant a church, we, our missions team, our outreach team heard about that, so we wanted to buy him a motorbike. And so so this is a motorbike. Now, that's a representation of a motorbike, but you can take that with you as well. But we want Godfrey to be able to plant that church, and we don't want those 10 kilometers each way to be a stumbling block. And so Romans talks about blessed be the feet of those who bring good news of the gospel. So we're blessing these rubber tires here. And so, church, just thank you for your generosity, because it's making a difference not just here but overseas as well. And so be praying for Godfrey. We're praying for Godfrey. We're thankful for you. Want to show you a picture of Cyprian's family there, and that's Nick and Andy and Kathy in front of the church there. But there's Cyprian's family. Last year, through the Multiply Initiative, we got the privilege of not just building that church, but also adding water filtration systems in the villages, but then also sending your family to school for a year. And we wanted to renew that commitment on behalf of the church to continue to provide for your family. And so, Cyprian, I don't say this often, but this is one of my pastors. This boy loves the word. He preaches the word. You know how much I love preaching? I don't get out of the way very often, right? But I got to sit under you for service. I love being one of your pupils, that you are one of my rabbis that's leading me towards Jesus. And so don't stop. Don't stop. Be faithful to the word of God. And so, again, we are thankful for this family. We're thankful for this ministry. If you're interested, maybe like Nick, you're sitting here going, yeah, there's no way I could go. That probably means you're going on our next trip. So in January, there's another trip. In May, September, we take multiple trips every year trying to support these pastors as they're planting churches. Also, if you just want to hear stories, if you just want to be inspired, we talked about the missionary heart last week that always is giving and is always looking for ways to point people towards the joy of Jesus, the certainty that he alone offers. Spend time with this boy. He's going to be here all week. So Thursday, November 2nd, right in here, I want to invite you to be a part of that as well. And so so we're going to dive into Luke. You got one more thing, I believe, before we go into Luke.
Okay.
Most of you know I'm not a huge animal guy. Big fan of pigs and lobsters. So, Cyprian, what is this?
This, in our culture, when someone, you know, really has been a great blessing to you, when you really appreciate someone beyond, you know, words, and you simply don't have what to do, other than praying for that person, you know, symbolically you would want to give him something, this is what you would give. You would give him a cock. So, I want, on behalf of the churches, this should not scare you, on behalf of the churches back home, on behalf of our ministry, we want to thank Vintage Grace Church. We want to thank Pastor Drew. Thank you for all the support. Thank you for praying for us. And this is what we are giving you.
I think I'm supposed to say thank you. You know, I've been overseas enough in most cultures. I do recognize that I don't have a choice in receiving this cock here. So, but Cyprian, we could not be more humbled to be partnered with you and your chickens. Church, man, if you have your Bibles, follow me in Luke chapter 20, and you are in for a treat. Let me pray for Cyprian as I get rid of whatever this here is. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for my brother Masambe, that you love him, that he is yours, that you have called him, that you have set him apart, and that we get the privilege of supporting what you're doing, not just here, but all over the world. So forgive us for the times as we pray at 1142 for the 42K, and we forget our brothers in Uganda and all over the world that are hopeless apart from you, but you've given us a certainty in your authority, Jesus. And so we submit to that and to the preaching of your word right now. We pray for your glory and for our good. Speak to us. Everybody said?
Amen. Thank you. So let's open our Bibles to Luke chapter 20, and we shall be reading from verses 1 to 8. Subtitle is The Authority of Jesus Challenged. The Authority of Jesus Challenged. All right. On one of the days, while he was teaching the people in the temple and preaching the gospel, the chief priests and the scribes with the elders confronted him. And they spoke, saying to him, "Tell us, by what authority you are doing these things? Or who is the one who gave you this authority?" Jesus answered and said to them, "I will also ask you a question, and you tell me, was the baptism of John from heaven or from men?" They reasoned among themselves, saying, "If we say from heaven, he will say, why did you not believe him? But if we say from men, all the people will stone us to death, for they are convinced that John was a prophet." So they answered that they did not know where it came from. And Jesus said to them, "Nor will I tell you by what authority I do these things." And from this portion of scripture, the text that we've just read, Jesus is in the temple, and he's preaching, he's teaching. This is the Passion Week. He's got little time remaining. It could have been around either Tuesday or Wednesday. And, you know, on Friday, he was going to be crucified. He was going to die. This is something that Jesus knew very well. But all the same, he's undeterred. He's going about the work of the kingdom. He wants to make most of the time. He wants to get as much knowledge disseminated, you know, to the populace, to the people, just before, you know, he leaves. So he's really on his final journey. And, you know, this is a very pivotal moment in the redemption plans of God, because, you know, the prophecy was being fulfilled. The prophecy that, you know, was given just that man had just fallen in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15, that, you know, the seed of a woman would bruise the head of the serpent. This prophecy was coming to pass. This was Jesus, the God-man, Jesus, the Son of God. He was here, and he had entered the final week, the week when he was going to give his life to redeem us, to pay for the penalty of our sins, to make it possible for us to be made right with God, for us to be, you know, not imputed, not to have our sins not imputed against us by simply accepting him. So this was what Jesus had come to do. He had got to the most important phase in his life. And Jesus is moving from being the leavened bread. You know, leaven is a picture of sin. So the unleavened bread. Jesus is moving from being, you know, the unleavened bread to becoming the life-giving bread. He's moving to becoming the bread of life. He's moving from just being, you know, the Passover lamb. You remember he had just celebrated that ceremony, and he had talked about, you know, the church, you know, new meaning being imputed to, you know, the breaking of the bread and, you know, taking of the cup during the Passover meal. And something new was happening. He was going to become the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. So it was a very important time. He's teaching, he's preaching. What was he preaching about? What was he teaching about? I can only imagine. But I would think that he was repeating the themes that he had kept on teaching. Probably some of the themes that he had earlier on taught, like for instance on the Sermon on the Mount. So I would think that he may have taught of, you know, sin, you know, and its wretchedness. He could have taught probably about judgment, the judgment that would come. He may have taught about the grace that was available. He may have taught about, you know, righteousness. He may have taught about the importance of humility. He may have taught about, you know, pride and how, you know, it can only lead to downfall. He may have taught about the deceitfulness of riches. He may have taught about the awareness of being, you know, just being aware of false teachers. He may have taught about the need for endurance. He may have taught about persecution. All these, I believe, were themes that, you know, he really wanted them to get ingrained into the hearts and minds of those who are listening to him. So I believe he was busy. As he is about this very important work, you know, the authorities come up against him. The scripture tells us the chief priests, the scribes and the elders, those who are the religious scholars of the day, they come and, you know, they ask him this question, that who gave you the authority to do these things? Or who is the one who gave you this authority? So who were these people? And these people were the priestly aristocracy of the day. And this, as we have already heard, comprised of these different groups. They were divergent groups, but on this occasion, they all converged, you know, upon Jesus. They all had one thing in common. And so they come against him. This group, this priestly aristocracy, did not believe that Jesus was sent by God. In spite of the numerous signs, wonders, and miracles that pointed clearly to the fact that Jesus was the Messiah, Jesus was the Savior of the world, they thought that Jesus was a rogue, masquerading as a spokesman for God. And so it's so amazing how those who were supposedly to be the religious scholars and the spiritual guides of Israel, how so spiritually blind they were. This teaches us something, church. Spiritual sight is not given by virtue of position or amount of knowledge one may possess. But, you know, though that knowledge is by all means very needful and important and impactful, but simply by virtue of having a relationship with God. So these powerful priestly aristocracy are the ones who run the temple and all its affairs and exercised their own authority over it. They also had their own vested interests, which they sought to guard. You know, the temple had become, you know, a commercial place. And so much was going on. You remember this big feast was underway. So throngs and throngs of people were coming to Jerusalem, were coming to the temple. It was a time of making great business for the merchants, for the money changers, because they had to change the Roman coin for the Jewish coin, the one that was accepted in the temple, the shekel, the Jewish shekel. So a lot was going on, and all these was happening under the watchful eye of the chief priests, of the Pharisees, of the scribes, of the elders. They had sanctioned this kind of business to go on. And, you know, Jesus later refers to them as, you know, a pack of robbers. You know, they had turned the church, they had turned the temple, pardon me, they had turned the temple into a den of robbers, a place where they kept their loot. So that gives me the impression that, you know, a lot was happening. They were oppressing the poor. There was corruption. There was greed. There was, you know, they had vested interests. They had, you know, their business interests that they by all means sought to gain. And so all this is happening. And that's why they come and ask Jesus, who gave you the authority? Who gave you the authority to do these things? Jesus was teaching and preaching in the temple. Jesus was resolute in spite of, you know, knowing that he had limited time. His earthly ministry, as we earlier said, was almost coming to an end. And he now made this final journey. He was on the very last journey of his life. It was a journey in which he himself would not only, as I had earlier told you, become the Passover lamb, but the lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. It was a journey of purpose, a journey of destiny, a journey of fulfilling God's destiny for his life, the reason for his birth, the reason for his life and ministry. It was time to fulfill the redemptive plans of God. So he was now set. He had now purposed. He was going to go all the way. And I want to define these words, if you would allow me. There's a word that needs to be defined. That is authority. Because this is what they come and they ask him, who gave you the authority to do these things. The Oxford Dictionary of Current English defines the word authority in the following terms. It says it is the right to act in a specified way, delegated from one person or organization to another. They also define authority as official permission or sanction. And thirdly, they also define authority as a person or organization having political or administrative power and control. So this powerful priestly aristocracy who run the temple and also exercise their own authority over it, they would know for sure that Jesus had not received the authority from them, the sanctioning from them, the permission from them, because they held the administrative authority over the temple. They were undisputed on that. They held the administrative control of the temple. However, they were also sure that Jesus had not been given permission by the Romans, who held the political authority or political power over the whole of Judea. Judea was by that time part of the Roman Empire. So they knew for sure they had not given Jesus the permission to teach in the temple. They had not given Jesus the permission to go and, you know, cause confusion and mayhem in the temple by overturning the tables, by, you know, whipping with cords the merchants. They, you know, they knew where this guy get this authority. They had a bureaucracy of leadership. They knew right from, you know, the high priest, the chief priest, the priests. They were, you know, packs and packs of priests. Everything was organized. Everything was streamlined. They knew. They had a delegated line of authority. So they come asking, you know, from their perspective, who gave you the authority to do these things? They would not accept any other human authorization as legitimate, nor regard other humans as divinely authorized other than them. They passionately believed that God had authorized them rather than someone else to be in charge of the religious aspects of the temple. Hence the confrontation. Who gave you the authority to do these things? They were demanding to know from their perspective, who gave you this permission? Who, show us your credentials. Who was your mentor? What approved institution did you attend that, you know, that we can, you know, base or rely upon that, you know what you are doing? You know, one thing at that time, the Pharisees and the scribes had a habit, the young scholars had a habit of putting on hats which bore the names of their mentors. They usually had, you know, celebrated rabbis whom the young, you know, scholars would go and sit and be trained and, you know, be mentored by. So you would find, you know, young scholars putting on probably hats with, you know, the name Rabbi Gamaliel or Rabbi Nicodemus, some of those well-known and celebrated rabbis. So Jesus was Jesus. He didn't need to put on anything. So, you know, they don't understand him. They come asking him, show us your credentials. You know, behind this, they have so many questions. How dare you? You son of a carpenter, as they thought. Because remember, they knew Jesus. They knew his background. They knew his parents. You son of Joseph and Mary. Who gave you the authority? You have never been to our seminaries. You have never been to our institutions. You don't have any credentials. All these are things that were going through their minds. And, you know, the next word that I would want to really lay emphasis on, to highlight it, so that we may get a better understanding of this portion, is they ask him, who gave you the authority to do these things? They talk of something in plural, these things. So there are many things that they had upon their hearts. There are many reasons that, you know, and grudges that they held against him. There was so much. So they ask, who gave you the authority to do these things? And the hostility between Jesus and the religious leaders could be traced to earlier on in his ministry. And it had not receded, but had just kept on mounting until now when it had got to a fever pitch height. Remember, Jesus had criticized their religion. He had attacked their theology. He had unmasked their hypocrisy. He had treated their entire religious system as if it was non-existent. He had been indifferent to the chief priests, to the Pharisees, to the scribes, and to the elders. And this was not only outrageous, but also unacceptable to them. So the hostility between Jesus and the Jewish religious leaders was, you know, just beyond, you know, any kind of measurable, you know, standard. Remember, these, pardon me, need to clear my voice. Remember, these were a group of people who loved elevation, who loved prominence, who loved the praise of men, and yet Jesus gave them none at all. You know, it can be very annoying when you think you really know, and then you are treated as if you don't know anything. So this is how they felt. And yet Jesus, you know, gave them none of what they wanted. He criticized their man-made, he criticized their mode of prayers. He attacked their way of fasting. He rebuked them for their way of giving. Thank you, Pastor. He belittled them for their love of titles like rabbi, teacher, father, etc. He told parables that they rightly perceived to be teaching against their way of conduct. Thus the question, who gave you the authority to do these things? And in Luke chapter 19 and verse 39, that allow me to quote Luke 19 verse 39, just the text just before the one we've read. I want to read verses 39 onwards. It says, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen, saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. The Pharisees had even intervened at this moment, asking him to rebuke his disciples, to which he answered, I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out. This and other claims infuriated them. It drove them nuts. Who was this Jesus, son of Joseph and son of Mary, as they thought? Who claimed to be an authority? A son of a carpenter? Who was this man who claimed to have authority over everything, they thought? He had claimed to have authority to forgive sins. He had claimed to have authority to lay down his life and take it up again. He had claimed to have power to rebuild the temple in 3 days. He had claimed to be the Lord, even of the Sabbath. All these claims drove them mad. Jesus claimed to be an authority in a way they were not used to. The chief priests, the Pharisees, the scribes, and the elders, the religious scholars of their day, could not comprehend this guy. After all, he had not been to their approved seminaries. He had not been ordained by them and did not have any approved credentials to do what he did, nor teach how he taught. Yet there was something undeniable about him, about this man. He taught as one having authority. He drew crowds by the thousands and was popular amongst the people. He also had power to perform miracles, signs, and wonders. He also drove out demons. He was full of wisdom, a wisdom that made it very difficult for them to try and trap him in what he said. All this made them hate him the more. They were envious of him. So the rulers now confronted him, demanding to know, who gave you the authority to do these things? Now it is helpful to know that the religious leaders in Jesus' day constantly quoted authorities to back up their teachings and to substantiate their points. Their teaching was typically a citation of other authorities to substantiate their point. They would say, Rabbi so-and-so says this, and Rabbi so-and-so acknowledges this, and Rabbi so-and-so permits this, and so on and so forth. But Jesus didn't teach this way. He often said something like this: you have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, if any man slaps you on the left cheek, turn to him also the right cheek. You have heard that it was said that thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say to you, if any man looks at a woman to lust after her, he has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Jesus' authority did not rest on other human authorities. Jesus' authority did not rest on other human teachers. His authority came directly from God. Hence the question, tell us by what authority you do these things. Jesus' authority was different. He was the God-man. He was the God incarnate. He had come on a specific purpose. Now the irony of all this is that this ends up becoming a confrontation between those with limited human originated authority coming up against the one who has all authority and power, as Matthew 28:18 tells us. Power over life and power over death. One by whom the heavens and the earth were created. The great I am who I am, as he revealed himself to Moses, had now come in a human form. The lesser confronts the greater. It is a clash between authorities. One is human, the other is divine. One is satanic, the other is divine. I say it is satanic because their underlying motive was not to seek knowledge. When they asked the question, by what authority do you do these things? Their motive was to kill Jesus. Their motive was to destroy him. Their motive was to get rid of him. They wanted him dead at all costs. Now, to add insult to injury, fuel to an already burning fire, Jesus goes to the temple in just the preceding chapter to this text. Jesus, while in the temple in Jerusalem, cleanses it through and through, throwing out the money changers, overturning the tables of those that sold merchandise, whipping with cords those that operated the stalls. I call this Christological violence. It was time to bring sanity back to the temple. Now remember, the temple, as we have earlier seen, was their turf. It was the domain. It was the area of influence of the chief priests, of the scribes, of the elders, and of the Pharisees. And Jesus now goes into the temple. And so you can imagine how greatly infuriated they must have been. They didn't like this. So in confronting Jesus, they wanted him to concede that he was not authorized by one of their approved institutions to do what he was doing. They probably wanted him to state that he was authorized by God, to which they would accuse him of blasphemy and then stone him to death, kill him by all means. They wanted him dead at all costs. They wanted to discredit him in the eyes of the people and then seize upon any opportunity to kill him. These divergent groups were in agreement on one thing: Jesus must be eliminated. But how to get it done was the challenge, because Jesus was popular among the people. They therefore feigned ignorance and asked what appeared to be a legitimate question: who gave you the authority to do these things? It was public knowledge that the chief priests, the scribes, the elders are the ones who had, you know, administrative power over the temple. And Jesus was in the temple. He was teaching the crowds. After he had chased out, you know, the money changers and those that, you know, sold pigeons or doves and cattle, and he was now in the temple every day teaching. And the Bible says the crowds hung upon his words. They were listening to him attentively. So, you know, they come and they bring and they pose a legitimate question. But behind their motives they have ill motives towards Jesus. They pose a legitimate question, trying to feign, you know, innocence or ignorance. And but he answered them, "I will also ask you a question. If you tell me, then I also will tell you where I do get this authority." Now, this was brilliant on the part of Jesus. No wonder, because he is the God-man. He is all-knowing. He is omniscient. He could see through their, you know, their hypocrisy. He knew what they were planning to do. He had earlier on told his disciples that I'm going up to Jerusalem, where the chief priests, where the scribes, and the elders will hand me over to the Gentiles, and they will kill me. And in 3 days, I will rise again. So he knew exactly what was going to happen. He knew the timeline of events and how things were going to turn out. He knew he had limited time, but he was resolute. He was, you know, determined. He was focused. He was pursuing destiny. He had you in mind. He had me in mind. And so he was going to go all the way. He was determined to be obedient to God's will to the last detail. And so, there's this confrontation. Jesus then asked them. It was common practice at times for a teacher or for a rabbi, you know, to answer a question by posing another question. So it was a way of getting them to interact and to think about, you know, a point. And now these religious leaders found themselves cornered. They said to themselves that, now, what should we do? Because John had come, and John had preached about the coming of the Messiah. John had told the people that after me comes one who is greater than me, the one whose sandals I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie. He had told the people, you need to repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. He had told the people to be on the lookout, and he had even told them that the one on whom you shall see the Spirit descend and remain, that is he who baptizes not with water as I do, but he baptizes with the Holy Spirit and with fire. So he had prepared the ground. He had prepared the people. He had done his part. All they had to do was to be observant. Undoubtedly, the miracles spoke for themselves. The signs spoke for themselves. The wonders spoke for themselves. The authority with which he taught spoke for itself. The wisdom of his word spoke for itself. The way he cast out demons spoke for itself. His authority over nature spoke for itself. Undisputedly, Jesus was King of Kings. He was Lord of Lords. He had accepted the claim when he was on that mezzanine, when he began the last journey, when he was on the donkey. He had accepted the public acclaim. They sang songs to him. And he didn't rebuke them. He accepted the knowledge. He acknowledged being King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But it is very unfortunate. But those who are supposed to be the spiritual guides of Israel were blind to this fact because their hearts were hardened, because they were interested in only one thing, keeping their entrenched positions. They were interested in only one thing, holding on to their preconceived ideas. They were not willing to embrace change. Anyhow, they then conferred with one another. What should we say? If we say that the baptism of John was from heaven, then he will ask us, why didn't you believe him? Because the truth is that these aristocratic or priestly aristocracy, they had rejected John the Baptist. They had not gone down to be baptized by John. They had missed the time of God's visitation. And so, they didn't know. They were ignorant and they were blind in their ignorance. So they then agree and say that, however, if we say that it was from men, the crowds will tear us apart. They will turn us into shredded meat, because even the crowds, even the common guys, all acknowledge John as a prophet of God. And so they go to Jesus and say, we don't know. And Jesus also tells them, neither will I tell you the authority or where I get the authority to do these things. Now I want to wrap up as I complete. I want us to get the main idea. What is the big idea in all this that we've read? The big idea, I would think, is that we too, just like Jesus, he's our model. He's the main character. He was resolute. He was determined. He was intentional. He, was totally sold out to pursuing God's purpose, God's destiny for his life. And so nothing would deter him, not even any amount of opposition, not even any amount of, challenging his authority would deter him from the course. So we too, in pursuit of the vision God has given us here at Vintage Grace, the great vision that Pastor Drew, and his team, expound very eloquently every Sunday and every weekday, we too need to be resolute. We too need to be determined. We too need to be intentional. We too need, to stand even in the midst of challenges, in the midst of opposition. We need to pursue the destiny that God has for us as a church family and also as individual families and as individuals. God has purpose and destiny before each and every child of God. And the good news is it is a great destiny. It's a great plan. So that's the big idea. We need to be resolute. We need to be determined. We need to be intentional in pursuing God's purpose, God's destiny for our lives. The take home number two, the second point that I would say, is that we need to expect challenges to come. We too need to expect challenges to come, and they will come, whether we expect them or we don't expect them. As long as we are Christians, as long as we are living in this fallen world, we too will be challenged. But remember, it is the less authority challenging the great authority. The enemy, Satan, will challenge you using any means. But remember, Jesus tells us, he has given us, that is in Luke 10:19, he has given us power to trample over scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy. And he says, nothing shall by any means hurt us. And another scripture tells us, greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world. We are definitely going to be overcomers. We are more than conquerors. That's what the Bible says. And thirdly, our take home would be ready to embrace change from our previously conceived positions. Let's be open. Let's be humble. Let's be willing to learn. Let's be willing to obey, put into practice, even if it means going through a mind shift. That's our purpose in coming here at church, that we may be instructed, we may be taught the word of God. Our motivation should be to continually grow and not to harden our hearts as the chief priests, as the scribes, and as the elders did. For them, they were not willing to change. They had their entrenched positions. And finally, take home number four would be spiritual sight is given to the meek, to the humble, and to those that are willing to learn. Those that do not desire to learn lose the ability to learn, as can be attested to Jesus' final statement to these leaders that neither will I tell you where I get the authority to do these things. If you don't make an effort to learn, if you don't make an effort to grow, if you are not willing to learn and to be humble and, meek and ready to, you end up losing the ability, as can be attested by the text that we've just read. I want to thank you for this time you've given me and for listening to me. Let's pray. King of glory, Almighty God, I want to thank you for this congregation. I want to thank you for the saints. I want to thank you for the leaders. And Father, it is my prayer that the church here at Vintage Grace may be resolute, may be determined, may be intentional in pursuing the destiny that you have for them, in pursuing the purpose you've called them to accomplish in this community. Lord, I want to thank you, Lord, for the vision that you've given to them. Lord, even in the face of challenges, it is my prayer that they may press on, they may keep pressing on. And Father, I pray that you may just give them, Lord, great success and great victories as they plant churches in different communities, as they plant joy-filled communities, as the statement, the vision statement of this church. Father, I pray that the vision will come to pass. I pray that many may come to the Lord, that they will make a great impact, not only here in their local communities, but even in different lands, in distant lands, that you may give them an international ministry. Just bless the ministry and for how much they have already been a blessing, Lord, to many who are far off. And I give you the praise, I give you the glory, and I give you all the honor in the name that is above all names, the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God.